Good. Happy Halloween. All right. I know I am. Like Jason said, I'm Michael Vittetoe. Farm just west of here, right on 92. Just down the road, so it's a pretty convenient spot to come talk. Here's my contact information, email or Twitter, or whatever. Follow me on there. Shoot me an email if you have a question. I'll post that up again at the end of the presentation, but feel free to contact me with any questions that you got, that you have. Okay, so here's some topics that we're going to be talking about today. I'm going to kind of give you guys an introduction to our farm operation, and then we're going to get into, you know, just understanding the soil ecosystem. We already talked about that a little bit today, but I'll give my spiel on it. And then we'll start talking about basics like cereal rye, and then we'll dive a little bit deeper talking about diverse stuff and some of the things we're working on, like our interseeded cover crops. And then I've also got some Haney tests that we've been doing along the way to show you guys. So here's a little overview of our operation. Here's our home farm. I'm up on top of one of our grain storage bins. You can see the cereal rye and the field around it. So our farm is a multi-generational family farm. I farm with my dad and grandpa as well. We farm about 1,400 acres. Cash crops are corn and soybeans. We've been no-tilling for about 30 years, or a little bit more than that even, way back in the 80s. Cover crops that we're using is primarily cereal rye, but we're also playing around with some diverse mixes. And then as far as livestock goes, we have a good amount of confinement hogs on our operation, so we have manure from that to help with our cash crops and whatnot. And then, like Jason said, I'm just starting to dabble in the cattle a little bit. I've got 2 cows, 3 steers, and 1 bull calf, so pretty big cattle operation that we have going on. But I'm playing around with mob grazing, amp grazing, whatever you want to call it. So we're moving every day using poly wire. With the hot fence. And then we also have a small free-range laying hen flock, about 25 laying hens. So they chase the cattle around, spread their manure out and whatnot. And then both of those products, the grass-fed beef and the eggs from the laying hens, we are going to be direct marketing those products direct to the consumers to capture as much of the food dollars we possibly can and help profitability. So, all right. This is a new one. I was doing research on this stuff and trying to figure out what to talk about, how to update my program. And a friend of mine actually posted this Dunning-Kruger effect graph on Facebook just the other day, and it definitely caught my eye. So if you look at this, you know, this is the bottom is your knowledge or wisdom on a subject. Here's your confidence level on the side. So you see this here, we have Mount Stupid. You know, Mount Stupid is, you know, pretty easy to get to. You get to it, you don't have to know a whole heck of a lot, you know. And it's pretty easy to get up there on top of Mount Stupid and talk about stuff when you maybe think you have it all figured out, but you really don't. So I feel like I definitely climbed Mount Stupid and then went crashing back down, you know, maybe sometime in the last year. Now I'm kind of starting to climb this slope of enlightenment back up slowly but surely as we kind of figure things out. So, you know, Mike earlier, he might be up here further on, a little more wisdom and knowledge than I have, but I thought that was kind of a good way to put it because, you know, the less experienced you are, the quicker you're going to be to think that you've got something figured out, but then the more you get it figured out, the more you realize that you know probably less than what you thought you knew. So, anyway, moving on. Something that I want you to think about while I'm talking up here is, you know, just what is the goal of agriculture in general? You know, what are we doing as the big picture? Are we growing grain or are we growing food for humans to eat? You know, what are we doing here? So, you know, are we just trying to get out here and run our combines through and have big, you know, full hoppers and whatnot? Or are we trying to grow food? So just think about that. Okay, so let's understand the system that we're working with. So when we're growing our crops, growing our food, they obviously need to have nutrients. We talked about that a lot earlier today. So where do those nutrients come from? Do they come from fertilizer? Do they come from manure? Do they come from the soil? their secret little nutrient fairy, Tinkerbell, there going around sprinkling nutrients on your soils? Or, I don't think so, but let's just kind of think about that a little bit. And you know, so looking at the fertilizer and manure, you know, we focused a lot in the past on controlling our rates and getting that right, and how we make our applications and getting all that stuff right. So do we want to keep just looking at that stuff, or do we want to focus on something new? You know, new, like the soil. It's older than dirt, but it seems to be the new thing. So let's start by looking at just the inherent nutrient quantities of the soil. So that's just, you know, the soil minerals and what they're made up of. So looking at nitrogen, phosphorus, and potassium, you know, look at some of these numbers that we have up here. Phosphorus, you know, we've got up to 12,000 pounds in the top 6 inches. Now that's quite a bit. It's more than what we need to grow our crops on. These numbers are so big, you know, we're obviously not going to be in the top of that everywhere around here, but we'll be somewhere in that range, probably, especially here in Iowa, on the top half of that. So how do we get access to these nutrient pools and not have to go out and make these fertilizer applications and whatnot that cost money and, you know, it's not the natural way to do things? How do we access that stuff? Okay, so what makes up our soils? We have our physical component, which is the sand, silt, clay, water, and air. And then we have our chemical component, which is our nutrients like our NPK, sulfur, etc. And then acid, and then our fertilizers that we're putting out in there. So what's missing in this picture? Does anyone know? Biology, all right. So here we go, add in the biology. You know, that biology consists of all the life in the soil, whether it's the plants, the fungi, the bacteria, the insects, livestock, etc. It all makes up the biology. And you know, when you think about the biology, look at this little guy over here. There are more microorganisms in a tablespoon of healthy soil than there are humans on the face of this earth. Think about that number. Think how many tablespoons of soil that you have in 1 acre, in 1 field, in your whole operation, and how many living organisms that you're responsible for taking care of and feeding them and helping them do their thing to help you do your thing. So a way to think about that is the soil biology is your soil livestock. You know, what do we do with our livestock? We make sure they're fed and watered and they have good habitat and everything. So we need to be doing those things for our soil livestock. Okay, so, you know, looking at the physical and chemical aspect versus the biology as well, you know, Mars is just the physical and chemical. There's not a whole lot of biology going on there, whereas Earth, we've got the biological component added in. So there's a pretty stark difference between the two. I want it to be over here like this and not like this. Okay, so we talked about the mycorrhizae earlier today. So here is a picture of a corn root, fine ear corn root, and you can see the mycorrhizae growing out of that. So you can see how much smaller they are, and you can imagine how many more places those mycorrhizae can get into than your corn roots can to access nutrients and water and everything else. So that's a huge part of why we're trying to support this biology, is to get more nutrients, get them unlocked, and make them plant available. So here's all of our soil livestock that we're talking about. You know, we were talking about the bacteria, the fungi, the nematodes and protozoa earlier, and then we've got our bigger stuff, our insects and earthworms, and even our small mammals and whatnot, like moles and voles and so on. So, you know, the big thing that we also talked about earlier today is that our growing plants, when they bring in the carbon from the atmosphere and utilize it through photosynthesis, then they're exuding that into the soil through their root tips in the form of liquid carbon, and we talked about this earlier. But they're using that, they're not just doing that because they want to do it, they're using that as a bartering system for those nutrients from that hyphae, from that mycorrhizae, and then that's how that symbiotic relationship takes place. The plants provide the carbon, the fungi and bacteria and everything provides nutrients to the plants in exchange for that. Okay, so we looked at this soil food web slide a little bit earlier as well. I added my own little tick to it over here where you've got your livestock, you eat plants, and then out the back side of the livestock, you get your organic matter, which then goes into the fungi, and go out into the rest of it, and the fungi also goes back and forth to the plant. So that's a big thing on why we need to be supporting these fungi. They're the only one on this that goes both ways. So otherwise, everything's got to go all the way back out and then cycle back through. So the fungi is the most direct way to get stuff to the plants. Okay, so how do we support and build this stuff? You know, what do we need to do to provide the habitat that these creatures need? So the first thing that we need to do is everyone needs to get rid of your own excuses. You know, I have plenty of times where I wish that I had never discovered any of this soil health stuff and that I was just, you know, going about things the way that we always went about things and you know, like, make it just go away. But that's, you know, you can't really do that after you learn some of this stuff. So you have to overcome your own excuses and, you know, put yourself in a mindset that you are going to make this happen and figure out how to make that happen. So after you can do that, then we need to have living roots in the soil 24/7, 365 to harvest that sunlight. And that's the driver of the whole system. Whether that be through cash crops or through cover crops, doesn't matter. Just a living plant is what we need to have. Not only living plants, but we also need plant diversity. And this is super important because different species of plants support different species of our biology. And we need all those different species of biology to make the whole system work. We didn't, you know, when the native system was out here, it wasn't made up of monocultures and whatnot. It had all kinds of different stuff going on. So that's what we need to imitate. We also need to avoid major stressors if and when possible. That would be things like tillage, pesticides, even just fallow periods where you don't have anything growing because we don't have that sunlight harvest going on during a fallow period. So that's a stress on our system. And then the cherry on top is livestock integration. You know, this is going to instantly boost our biology through feces, urine, saliva, and so on and so forth. There's all kinds of good stuff that comes right out of the animal, and if you can put it right on the soil, it's going to be in its best form possible. You know, with our confinement swine manure that we have, it comes out of the livestock into a pit and it sits there for up to a year before we finally take it out and put it on the field. And you're not going to convince me that there aren't changes happening in that deep pit that are negative for the biology. So we're not getting a full boost out of that. It's better than commercial fertilizer, don't get me wrong, but it's not as good as having it go straight out the animal onto the soil. So that's a big part of it. Okay, so let's talk about cover crops. Mitchell likes this slide. So like any millennial, I just got on Google and looked up what is a cover crop. You know, so it's crop grown for the protection and enrichment of the soil. All right, well, kind of makes sense. I don't think it has to be anything special. I just think it's any plant that's grown purposely without taking it as a cash crop. So you don't necessarily have to go out and plant it. It could be something, a native species, or, you know, I like to call them native species now, but some people call them weeds. It could be a weed or a native species that you're, you know, that's doing the same thing. You know, you've got problems that come along with weeds from time to time, like seed production and whatnot, and having more of them in the future, but you're getting benefit out of those. So if you want them there, you know, it's not that big of a deal, I guess. So most people in Iowa, it's just cereal rye. You know, that's the only thing that most people use around here because it's one of the things that works the best and it's easy to grow and it works pretty darn good. Skeptics, you know, they're going to say it's a yield-robbing weed and crop nuisance. You know, Mike talked about one of his skeptics down in Tennessee that thought cover crops were responsible for world hunger and everything else, you know. But they do have their drawbacks, and we'll talk about some of that in a little bit. And then the fanboys like myself, it's the best thing since wide mouth cans. I definitely like having that extra flow on my beverage in the evening. So some benefits of cover crops, You know, number one is stimulate the soil biology. Number two is the livestock grazing. I think those are super, super important because they go hand in hand in helping our native system and everything work together. Next up is erosion control and water infiltration. You know, that's super, super important because obviously once our soils erode away, we're not getting them back to where they were before. So then we have to start over and build new, and that takes a long, long time, especially if you're continuing to have it erode away. So along with infiltration, and that comes the water quality, whether it be from nitrogen or phosphorus loading. You know, the nitrogen factor comes from nutrient scavenging, so we're not having as much nitrogen leach down into the profile and into the waters through our tile and runoff and so on and so forth. We also get good weed suppression from cover crops if you utilize them properly. You know, you look at this picture here, this is a cereal rye cover crop ahead of soybeans. It got rolled down by a planter tractor, I think. So you can see the thatch that created, and that's going to do a good job of suppressing weeds. It's not necessarily going to keep them out all season long, but it's going to knock them back and make them have a hard time growing through that. So along with that comes the carbon sequestration. You know, there's a lot of carbon tied up in that, and it's going to eventually make its way into the soil. And anytime we can have carbon tied up in plants in our soil, as opposed to being in the atmosphere, it's going to do us a lot more good than it is harm. And then certain cover crops can fix nitrogen out of the air. The legume cover crops can, and that can help in order to balance out that extra carbon that we're getting through the C to N ratio that we talked about earlier. And not all cover crops accomplish all this stuff. So you got to make sure that you know what you're using and do your homework on these species before you go and just plant them because someone told you to. Okay, so some negatives of cover crops. All right. They can be antagonistic to your cash crop if not managed properly, and whether that be through nutrient tie-up, through pathogen harboring, or insect pests, or a number of other variables that could happen. You know, you'll take a look at this picture. This corn seedling, his root here is not feeling too great. He's got some seedling disease going on, and we'll talk about that again in a little bit, what happened in this exact situation. But again, another negative is the time and money that it takes to utilize these cash crops, whether it be your seed, your herbicide, and then as far as the time goes, your labor and equipment that you're utilizing in an already busy season, as we're typically putting this stuff in at harvest time, and we're already, you know, crazy busy at that time, and who has more time even yet to go out and put in a silly cover crop. So, and then it's also just another layer and variable to manage in an already complex system. So everything takes a learning process, and there's a drawback to everything. So these are some of them that we've got with our cover crops. So looking at the seedling disease part of it, I think a lot of that has to do with rotational sequencing, and that's something that you need to pay attention to, you know, especially if you're using monoculture cover crops. So ideally, with our cash crops, we want to be rotating the opposite season and opposite leaf structure. So for a warm season broadleaf, like soybeans, we want to have a cool season grass ahead of it. That's why cereal rye works so good ahead of soybeans. So then with corn, it's a warm season grass, so we would like to have a cool season broadleaf ahead of it. But the problem is it's super difficult to establish a cool season broadleaf after soybean harvest around here, because we're typically out, you know, October or even late October. There's just not a lot of time because a lot of those species aren't as winter hardy as something like rye. So that's where rye typically ends up going, rye to corn, rye to soybeans, on both of them around here. And that's why we've got some of those problems with our seedling disease and so on. Okay, so let's talk about rye a little bit more. You know, it's the most popular cover crop in the Midwest, especially in Iowa. Like I mentioned earlier, it's cool season grass that's super winter hardy. It's got a good root system, so it's going to help with our soil aggregates. It's supportive of the mycorrhizal fungi that we talked about earlier, so it's going to help boost that, get certain species of that going. It's super good with erosion control because it's so winter hardy and because it's a grass and it's got a good root system, so it's going to help hold everything down. It's a good nutrient scavenger. It takes up as much nitrogen as it possibly can, which leads to problems ahead of corn because corn likes those nutrients as well. It's kind of high maintenance. It's easy to establish. You can go out and spread it. You can drill it. You can do pretty much whatever. You're going to at least get somewhat of a stand without a whole lot of effort. It's good for grazing. You know, cattle like it. I found that out firsthand this spring. They went nuts over it. But it's only one species. You know, diversity is key, and this is only one species. So here's a picture of some rye on our operation last May, ahead of soybeans. Okay, so let's talk about our current program on our operation ahead of corn. So I don't like to go out and put a full bushel out there ahead of corn. NRCS, if we're doing cost share, makes us put on at least a half bushel. I'd be okay with putting on less than that, but I can live with a half bushel. We're using twin rows on our drill for our rye ahead of corn, so that way we've got like a 8-inch twin row and then a 22.5-inch gap, a 22-inch gap that we can plant our corn down and do other nutrient applications and whatnot. So, to back up on this half bushel, for cost share, if you're doing that, you have to add in another species to get your rate percentage up to at least 100%. So full rate of rye for cost share is a bushel, 55 pounds. So we're putting on a half bushel, we've got 50%. So you take another species, like a winter kill species, such as oats or rapeseed. Oats, full rate is 60 pounds. So you need 30 pounds of oats, 50% of a rate. Add that in with the 27.5 pounds of rye, and you're good to go for your cost share. Rapeseed is what I'm going to be using this year. Full rate of that is 3 pounds. So I need 1.5 pounds of rapeseed, which costs like $1.10 an acre, or $1.10 a pound. So that gets our cost down, and we're getting another species other than just a cereal crop out there. So rye and rapeseed is what we're going to be having ahead of corn for our operation. So in the fall, I like to have rye where we're putting our hog manure down. So we're tanking our hog manure on, and this last year we went out and we tanked our manure on down our 22-inch gap between the rye rows, so we essentially strip-tilled it right where we were going to plant our corn, and it worked pretty slick. So then in the spring we planted our corn on that strip. We put on starter, about 3.5 gallons of starter in furrow, and then we also put on 20 gallons of 32% nitrogen with the planter, just in a 2x0x2. Dribbling on out the back, had pretty good luck with it. We terminate our rye with glyphosate. You know, some people aren't fans of glyphosate, but it's been pretty reliable for us. You know, we get good kills with it every year. So our timing on that termination ahead of corn is going to be determined on the growth conditions that spring. So if it's aggressive growth in the spring, the rye's getting really big early, we might go out and take it out earlier when it's smaller, you know, in that ankle high range ahead of corn. If it's super slow growth like we had this year, we might plant it green or even plant and then terminate after planting. You know, crop insurance allows you in our area, if you're no-tilling, to terminate up to 12 days after planting. So let's look at some pictures. This is 2017.
Michael, I want to interrupt you quickly. So crop insurance in Iowa will not allow you to plant green like plant today that you...
Yeah.
They'll let you plant it green, but you got to get it within 1 or 3 days?
You can plant it green.
Okay.
And then I think if...
You have to terminate before emergence.
Yeah, before emergence, you have to terminate it before emergence. And if you're in a no-till system, you have 12 days. Whichever comes first,
okay.
Or 12 days. Okay, so this is 2017, so this is last year, which I don't know, some of the guys that are more experienced with cover crops in here, this is probably some of the most aggressive rye growth that we had in the spring in a long time. So you can see this was early March, this is late March. There's a lot of growth on that stuff. Those are twin rows, so the rows are almost closed here by the end of March. We hadn't killed it yet. Here we are planting on April 15th. It's quite a bit more growth. There it was after we planted immediately following. So it planted real nice and whatnot, plenty of moisture, closed the trench up and everything. You can see where the after planting, we just were barely getting the corn up out of the ground. So it took a long time, and it took a lot of nail chewing, nail biting in that meantime before that stuff came up. We were pretty nervous. But it ended up pulling out of it pretty good. You can see a decent looking corn crop here. One thing that did happen, since we didn't roll that rye down anywhere that the tractor didn't drive and the rye was still standing, that rye fell over top of the corn rows, and then we had voles out in the field that would come out right around their burrow and just pick corn plants out right down the row. 4 or 5 rows wide, 30 feet long. So we'd have big patches where there was no corn, and then patches where it was perfect, you know. So, and it wasn't the whole field, it was just little isolated places, but it was something that we noticed where the tractor had rolled it down with the tires, none of that was happening. It was out on the wings where the rye was still standing. So something that we're looking at is if our rye does get big ahead of corn like that, we want to be rolling that stuff down and get it laid down. That way the voles don't have cover from our cover crop to hide from the predators like, you know, eagles and so on and so forth, just to kind of keep them in check, because when they have that cover, they're free to do whatever they want. Okay, so let's look at this year, 2018. Slow spring growth. So this picture's from April 20th. That would be 5 days after we planted that corn. You know, think about what that rye looked like when we were planting, and then look at this stuff. This is even 5 days later. So this would be some of the slowest spring growth. So we went from the fastest to the slowest all in one season, from one season to the next. So here we are, April 30th. We're planting our twin rows. Here we are, May 12th. We had a rye termination date trial with PFI on this field. So the left here was terminated 4 days before planting, and this stuff was terminated about 8 days after planting, right before the corn emerged. You can see the corn coming up in here. So here we are on the 21st. You can see the corn coming up in the late termination. The corn's up in the early stuff. One thing you notice in here, we've got a whole bunch of little water hemp seedlings that germinated in the early termination, but then over in the late termination, there wasn't anything. There was no residuals on any of this stuff yet. It was all just Roundup termination for the rye. So this is true blue rye weed suppression at its finest, you know. So the rye weed suppression had worn off on this early terminated stuff because it had been, almost a month after it had been terminated, and this stuff was just 2 weeks-ish, 10 days. So this was still suppressing it. This stuff wasn't. So that weed suppression, allelopathy and whatnot, it goes away over time. So this kind of gives you an idea of when that happened. Here we are on June 2nd. Side by side, not a whole lot of difference. Okay, so any questions on the corn stuff?
What this is this year kind of yield data, but do you have yield data from prior year?
From the 17 stuff?
With these two next to each other?
We didn't have a side by side 2 years ago. So this will be published in the PFI trial book or whatever it is this year though. Okay, so ahead of soybeans, what we do is we like to go out and drill our rye on 15-inch rows, just a function of the drill that we have. I like to use 40 to 55 pounds, so between 40 pounds and a full bushel of rye, and then, you know, if we're cost sharing it and we're using less than that, then we use the oats or grapeseed or whatever we're using to reach our full rate. And then terminate with glyphosate again, either at planting time or up to 12 days after. So with beans, I'm not a fan of going out and terminating it early ever. I want the rye to get as big as we can possibly get it. I'm even okay with waiting for a while after we plant our beans to terminate the rye, to help wick up that spring moisture that we usually have around here. And we usually tank mix our residuals with the glyphosate in that termination pass, and we have good luck with it, but don't skimp on your glyphosate rates if you're doing. Something that we've got on the radar is, again, rolling the tall rye after planting. I'll show you some pictures of why we're looking at that. And then we're also looking at relay cropping, which would be, you know, go in and plant your beans like you normally would, and then let the rye grow. row and harvest it for seed, and then let your beans take over and harvest them for grain. It's a tricky operation, but there's people that are working on it, and I think it's pretty intriguing, so we might try it a little bit. Okay, so here's that. We showed this picture earlier. This is rye in May of 2017, right before we planted soybeans. Here we are planting the soybeans. Here we are in June after we killed it. And you can see that thatch of rye, since we didn't roll it down, it was just kind of up there and starting to fall down and laying on top of the beans, and everything's all tangled up and whatnot. You know, we might be blocking a little bit of sunlight and whatnot, but we're especially blocking sunlight down, you know, when we look later in the year. We're blocking sunlight down to the lower leaves on these plants. So then what that's going to do is it's going to make our bottom nodes of those soybeans not put pods on. And then we end up, here we are in August, then we end up with this situation where our bottom pods are, you know, 8-10 inches off the ground. Which makes it easy to get them all when you're cutting, but you're giving up some yield on that by not having anything on those bottom pods. The other problem, you know, you can see the rye standing here between the rows. If you try and cut your soybeans with the row, with your header, that stuff is not going to cut real well. It's all pretty rotten by this point, and it's just going to plug up your sickle guards, and then you're going to be fighting that all day long. Not fun. So you pretty much, if you don't roll that down, you're going to have to cut on an angle. Unless you're, you know, if you're drilling, you're going to get that all knocked down. But we're on twins. If you're on 30s, you're going to have the same scenario. So that's just something to keep in mind. That's how you're going to manage that come harvest time as well. Any questions on the soybean stuff? Okay. Moving on, you know, we're going to get a little more advanced here. Start talking about some other species than rye. You know, there's hundreds of individual plant species, or even more than that probably, that we can utilize as cover crops, and you know, they consist of warm and cool season grasses and broadleaves, and any mix of those in between. And they, you know, you can tailor your mixed species to meet your individual goals and needs. But the biggest problem with all these other species is they're more difficult to get established, and we touched on that earlier. So the big thing that we need to remember, you know, and I mentioned this earlier, is that you're only going to get the maximum benefit when you're using a mix of diverse plant species. So, can't say that enough. Diversity is the key to having all of this stuff work. Okay, so how do we add this diversity? Because obviously we're not going to be able to do very much after soybeans, even after corn is tough. So, some people are adding a third crop, whether it be wheat, rye, oats, barley, etc. You get that small grain in there, you harvest it in the summertime, and then you have a full open window, second half of summer, to go in with a big diverse mix, and you can get a lot more stuff established. This is tough because of lack of markets to sell to around here. Prices aren't as good, as attractive as it is for corn and beans for us. So profitability can be a challenge. You know, something that you can do to add some dollars to this aspect is to graze these cover crops that you're planting afterwards, and then that might help things pencil out a little bit better. So, you know, being creative on how you can turn this stuff into dollars is important. So another way would be full season cover crops for grazing. This is something I'm looking at doing a little bit next year. You know, you would go in the fall and see your rye or triticale or whatever you're wanting to use. And then in the spring, you would go in and graze that. You'd probably be able to get at least 3 passes off of that, whether it be 1 in the fall and 2 in the spring, or even 1 in the fall, 3 in the spring. You can get, you know, potentially you can get quite a bit of grazing off of this stuff, especially if you're using the daily moves and staying off of it from a continuous grazing standpoint. So that's what you're going to do in the spring. And then in the summertime, you go in, you know, after you beat that rye down, you're going to go in and put a full season, warm season mix in that will be planted in early summer, and then you're going to be grazing that all summer long, you know, through early fall even, and you'll be able to get, I would say, at least 2 passes. I've done a little bit of it this year, and I'm thinking I'm going to get 3 passes, no problem, potentially even 4 with cattle. And then after that, you would go back in and seed your cool season mix and rotate either back to row crops or do the same rotation, full season grazing all over again. So what about perennial pastures? Okay, well this is, I have a little bit more of this year, but it's still just a tiny little bit. But what I did was went through and either grazed the spring big cool season grass growth off and then drilled my interseed mix plus sorghum Sudan grass into that pasture. And then we also did it where we hayed some of it. So I both grazed grass and hayed grass and then drilled a 12-way mix into it with both warm and cool season species. And I've already gotten, I'm on my second pass through the cover crop mix of grazing, and I don't think it'll be a problem to get a third pass later on this summer. And that's a pretty good looking cattle feed. You know, they get into that, and we're going to go by there afterwards. Yeah?
Did you get better, more production after the hay or after the grazing? Or did you notice a difference?
So the question was, did we get better production after the hay scenario or after the grazing scenario? And what I've noticed was the larger seeded species, like the sorghum, Sudan grass, and I've got cowpeas and soybeans in there and whatnot, they were able to fight through that grass, the existing pasture stand, and get going. And then once we got some rains, they were up above that stuff, and they were off to the races. Whereas on the hayed stuff, everything kind of popped up right away, but it got like this tall, and then it just stalled out. You know, because there wasn't that cover there, and it didn't have that animal impact yet, because it hadn't been grazed yet, ever, for a long, long, long time anyways. And so it wasn't, and I've got pictures of it that I can show you afterwards, but we were able to get more stuff established, but we didn't get as much growth out of it. Now that I've been across it once, it's more even with the other stuff, and there's more species in there. So, you know, but this was grazed, and this was grazed as well. This was the first pass that was about 3 weeks ago, and then this was just taken yesterday. So yeah, you'll get some good forage production out of that. Yeah. I pulled out of the cornfield from interseeding, threw some sorghum in it, and pulled it into this. So it's all twin rows. You can see there. So just left everything kind of set the same, opened up the rate a little bit more. Yeah?
What do you think that'll do to your perennial grasses that are in there?
I mean, they seem fine. I mean, you can see them in there. And they'll, so when the cattle go through this, you, after they're done grazing it, you won't see any sign of that sorghum Sudan grass in there. They'll have it eaten down to a nub, and then the perennial grass looks fine, and then that sorghum will start growing back up out of it, is what I've seen so far. I haven't seen any problems with it. That, you know, obviously this is my first year doing it, so I don't have, I'm up on top of Mount Stupid right now. I like what I'm seeing from it. And I don't know how it would do if you were on 7.5-inch rows and you were, you know, covering it up more, whereas we've got, you know, our 20-inch gap in between to allow that sunlight down to our perennial grass, and we're not choking it out as much. So, yeah.
What do you have in there for a mix?
So obviously sorghum Sudan grass is the corn looking stuff here, and then cowpeas, soybeans, four different types of clover, flax, buckwheat. Spring lentils, a little bit of spring peas.
How'd you come up with the mix that you used?
I mean, that was what I used for interseeding. And when I came up with that mix, I was looking for a heavier legume mix since we're planting it into the corn. And a mix of cool, warm and cool season on both of those. And highly mycorrhizal species since it was a intercrop type situation. We're trying to help everything work together. So it was just, you know, I obviously don't have the interseeding thing figured out. We'll talk about it in a little bit, but I don't have it down to a science either, but that's just kind of what I've been using for it. Since I already had the seed in the drill, that's what ended up here. So.
Are you able to buy that seed locally, or do you send off for it?
About a quarter mile yonder, transed out, where I get all the cover crop seed. So, okay. Any other questions on that? I've got more pictures of it. And if anybody wants to stop by, I'm more than welcome. so if you're not sold on adding to third crop or grazing livestock, what do you do? You know, do you just stick with rye, or do you think outside the box? So if you want to think outside the box, you got to look for answers in the native system. And Iowa's native system is a tall grass prairie. What's a tall grass prairie consist of? It's got a dominant warm season grass, and then a diverse population of forbs living alongside it. And this system is capable of supporting a significant amount of biodiversity. You know, doing research on what was a tall grass prairie and whatnot, there wasn't a whole lot of info, but I was able to find a thing where over by Lincoln, Nebraska, there was 237 plant species recorded in 1 square mile. So that one section, 237 plant species were identified in there. You know, how many do we have in a section here in Iowa, you know, in our fields? You can probably count them on two hands even, and most of those are going to be weeds, or what we consider weeds or native species, as I like to call them now. So, you know, what effect is that having on this system, and what's that doing to what we're working with, and, you know, how can we bring that diversity back? So that's where looking at interseeding cover crops into our corn can help us with that. You know, so what you do is you drill a diverse mix into the corn at V2 to V6, somewhere in that ballpark, and then your corn is your dominant warm season grass, and then your interseeded covers are your population of forbs. So you're very closely imitating the native system. Now we've only got like 12 or 13 species in there, but it's better than one. So here's kind of my spiel on interseeded cover crops. You know, this is our third year doing it, and I've yet to really figure it out, but we've had some success with it. But what I found is it's very difficult to find a balance between corn yield, weed control, and cover crop growth. You know, one of those is always kind of going to be out of whack. So there's a lot of variables to control on that, but that's kind of, in a nutshell, the biggest challenge that I've had is finding that balance. So there is big potential to make strides, even in just 1 year, using this type of system. So in 2017, in the field I'll show you some pictures of, we increased our phosphorus by 300 pounds per acre just in 1 year. And I've got, this is all using the Haney test that we were looking at earlier. So you'll see the graphs for that stuff. And then our WEOC levels, our water extractable organic carbon, went up from 225 to 450 parts per million in 2017. And it's continued to progress in 18 as well. So big part of this, you know, obviously the weed control, we utilize a partial rate of our residual herbicides. Our first year we used atrazine and acetichlor, a half rate of both of those, so that ended up being about 8/10 of a pound of atrazine and a pound and a half of acetichlor. And that worked pretty good. We had minimal damage to our cover crop seedlings, and we had pretty decent weed control from it. This year we went with Acuron, a quart and a half of Acuron, which is a half rate. That consists of atrazine, dual, Callisto, and another group 27 active ingredient, and we had pretty significant herbicide injury to our covers, especially the small seeded stuff. So that could be a challenge. I like, if we're going to do it again next year, I'm gonna do a program similar to this and not use the Acuron. I don't know if it was the Callisto that threw us off or what it was this year, but we had too big a losses to do it again. Something I've noticed is if you look at planting your corn later, you're going to probably have better weed control because you're kind of changing up your cycle and how your management works with the weed control, and it's going to throw those weeds off as far as what they're used to and how they're used to growing alongside your cash crop. So we've had better luck with that. So some pictures, here we are in 2017. We went in and drilled our coverage pre-emerge in 17. You know, we got kind of ornery on that. You can see the mix here. I think that was an 11-way mix, similar to what the mix I put in the pasture mentioned earlier. So here we are about a month afterwards. So you can see the covers growing between the corn. There we are, June 21st, so that's summer solstice. see the mustard and the radish. The mustard's the yellow, the radish is the white. Going to reproductive mode. Here we are, July 4th. You see the seed pods on there. Got, I didn't even have to seed mustard this year. I had it already in there. So here's what the corn looked like on July 4th. So this is before tassels were out by about 2 weeks, but the corn was looking pretty good. But right around this stage, we started to run out of nitrogen in the field, and that really hurt our corn yield. You can see also how tall those cover crops were. Those brassicas, once they went reproductive, they can really stretch vertically. And so then they're competing with sunlight, especially on our ear leaves, on our corn, and that's not a good thing. That. Okay, so then looking at any test results from this field, you know, I mentioned the big bump in phosphorus. So here we are, the blue line is this field, and then the green line is the average for our area from all the tests that Mitchell's done. And you can see, you know, especially late there in July and in the fall and October, we had a big boost in that phosphorus level. And that, you know, I didn't go out and put a whole bunch of fertilizer out right where Mitchell was pulling that test. So it's just the way it happened. Here's our WEOC levels. You can see them climbing throughout the season. Here's our K levels. Not quite as drastic, but it's still climbing. You know, 500 at the start to 650 at the end. And then here's a standard soil test, you know, a Malik and Paray test. So, you know, that's showing over 1,000 pounds per acre or a P. 230, 240, and this is showing at 650, so that gives you an idea. This is at the same time as the fall time period, so that gives you an idea of just how much harsher those acids are on the Malic and Bray extractants than the H3A that Haney uses. So there's, you know, this gives you an idea of what's all in there, but this is all readily available. So that's the difference between the two. So then this year in 2018, you know, we didn't want to have quite as much competition, so we waited a little bit longer. The corn was V2, V3 in that ballpark when we went in and drilled. So then here we are, what, 10 days afterwards, after we drilled. It wasn't growing as fast because the small seeded species, as they would come up and transition from surviving off their seed to surviving off the soil nutrients and water and whatnot, they would take up that residual herbicide and then just disappear. So here we are again. You know, you can see these guys, see some yellow, see some flashing around the outside, not looking real hot, especially on these small seeded guys. So they would either get sick and die or just kind of hang out there for a little bit, and it took a while for them to get going. But the big seeded stuff, large seeded stuff, spring peas, there's an oat, there's a cowpea, there's buckwheat. Buckwheat's not a real big seed, but it's big enough. Those guys were able to deal with that residual a lot better and kind of keep growing or hang on a little bit longer throughout that. Here we are June 15th, so finally we're getting through that residual. You can see some smaller seed stuff. There's some flax. You can see some clovers in there. But things are pretty small at this point, and at June 15th this year, we were like V12 probably. We were pretty far along. Tassels came out end of June. So that corn was big. There wasn't a whole lot of sunlight getting down to that stuff anymore. And it's just now trying to get established, whereas ideally we would have had it getting established when that canopy was open, but instead it was getting taken out by our herbicide. So there's that balancing act that you have to play as well. Here we are, June 25th. And then just the other day I was in there. You can see some cowpeas left. But a lot of little water hemp species. So Mother Nature saw that all of our other stuff was dying off, and she gave us a couple species of interseed and of her own native species in there. But they're not, I mean, they're small enough, they're not competing with the corn, you know. So it doesn't really hurt my feelings all that much, except for the seed production part of it. And they're not going to produce too much, but I'd rather not have any more water hemp seed deal with than I have to. So, okay. Any questions on the interseed stuff while we're here?
We'll try it again next year?
We'll see. It's not a definite because I've got other stuff that I'm more interested in. And that's what we're going to talk about here. So spring seeded cover crops is something that I am taking a liking to, and maybe I'm just on top of Mount Stupid on it as well, whereas I've already crashed off on interseeding a little bit. But so the goal is to seed a diverse cool season mix in early spring, like as soon as you can get the drill through the field. And you know, you put those cool season species in there because they're going to be hardy enough to deal with a couple frosts and whatnot, like your peas and oats and spring barley and some of that type of stuff. They'll be able to deal with some frosting, especially if you plant them like an inch deep. We tested that this year. But then you're going to want to delay your corn planting to mid or even late May, and by doing that, you're going to maximize the benefits from your cover crops by giving them time to grow and do their thing and help the soil biology instead of killing them when they're really small, if you want to plant corn in April by doing this. And, you know, everybody kind of freaks out when you say delay your corn planting to mid to late May, but this is a totally different scenario than if it were fallow or tillage and you're delaying it to that time period. You know, it's two totally different things. You have to look at it two totally different ways. So then you terminate the cover crops at planting time and plant your corn. If you're doing this with soybeans, you could potentially just plant them at the regular time or maybe a little bit late, because we're typically doing that in mid-May anyways, and you know, terminate them at planting time or up to 12 days after, and that would probably work just fine. We have not done this ahead of soybeans, but I know other people that have. I think you can get some good grazing out of this stuff too if you're a cattle guy, you know. So it's going to be at a different grazing window when some of your other stuff might be, you know, at a different stage, or you might have already grazed it and you're trying to let it recuperate a little bit. This stuff would be ready in that time window, I think. So that all kind of ties in together. So here's a picture of it when we were out drilling March 15th. So as you can see, this all has rye on it back here, and there's like nothing growing yet, not even the rye. Obviously the waterways were dormant until May as well. So we were out there pretty early. It was plenty gummy. I set the drill at like an inch deep and had hardly any down pressure, and it was just going right in because it was, you know, super mellow. Frost that just came out. I think we had a 8-way mix or 9-way mix. Spring peas, spring oats, spring barley, flax, a handful of different types of clovers, and then we also had buckwheat, which is a warm season species that I threw in there just to see how it would work out. And yeah, you'll see how that turned out. So here we are, May 2nd. So again, March 15th is when we drilled it. May 2nd, we're just starting to get some stuff coming up because we had such a long, cool spring. You know, it was just one of those years. I was out there checking it like almost every day. I'm like, are you guys still alive? They're in there in the ground, just kind of hanging out, not doing much, but everything was still there. May 5th, there you can finally start to row it. So this was in a field that got interseeded last year. So we had the mustard and radish seed already in there as well. So that stuff will start coming up as well later on. There you can see some mustard, the jagged edges around it. So May 13th, you know, look at where we're at on this growth stuff. It was really starting to rock and roll at this point in time. The weather was warm. We had plenty of moisture. You can see we must have got a rain that day. See the oats and barley starting to grow. There's a spring lentil plant, almost looks like a vetch. So you can see we just got a mix of all kinds of good stuff out there growing together, doing its thing. There's a native species. Little lamb's quarter. Okay, so here we are, May 17th. A little more growth on it. You see the peas starting to stretch out, climbing up on the cereals. May 21st. Quite a bit of growth. Look at that. That's 4 days. So it's made some progress. So then we had 3 more days before we terminated it on May 24th. And unfortunately, I don't have any pictures of it at that time, but there was all kinds of stuff going on. We had clovers flowering. We had brassicas flowering. We had good stuff going on when that was in the plant. So here we are, May 31st, after we planted. So a week afterwards, we got corn up. Pretty much all of it was up at that point. And then, so I got cute and tried terminating this field with Liberty because it had a lot of broadleaves in it, and I was worried about Roundup getting a good kill. And yeah, what ended up happening was it just burned everything pretty bad, and we did not get a good kill. And down here at this area, it started kind of greening back up early. So I went back out with the spot sprayer, hit that stuff with Roundup to knock it out, and got a good kill on that stuff. I hit everything I thought had any chance at all of coming back to life. And then, of course, here's the line where I started that, and you can see it growing back up. So we had a delayed termination trial on this as well. So here's that line, and you can see this stuff over here. We're on June 12th, see that corn, where it's at. You know, here's a better view of it, June 15th. There's a corn plant, there's a corn plant, there's a corn plant. We were pretty hot and dry at this point, too, so it was kind of all rolled up and whatnot. We got barley heading out in here. We got all kinds of stuff flowering. There's corn in there. You know, I was pretty worried about it, but it's, you know, it's just three rows for a couple feet. So here we are after we sprayed it. This was when I was in here interceding. This was Father's Day. I had my son Wyatt with me. He fell asleep like right after that picture. He was tired. But so I interceded cover crops into this field again about this time. And then here it was on June 25th. So this was that area where all that stuff was growing, you know, where all those weeds were competing with the corn. And it's coming out of it pretty decent, I would say. You can't hardly tell. Here's the interseeded cover crops, there's a cowpea, buckwheat, all kinds of stuff going on. So then July 5th, oh, so right after that was when that mix went and got drilled into the pasture that we were talking about earlier. Here we are July 5th, you can see the clover's coming along, you can see the cowpeas getting kind of tall, buckwheat in there. July 25th, things are a little bit taller. We lost some of our lower stuff in there, you know, corn grew really fast. It's one of the reasons why I'm not 100% sold on this interseeding stuff around here, because it seems like every year we either have too much competition or we lose out on this stuff like the clovers and whatnot that I want to have in there for the winter and next spring. So then this was just the other day. You can see the cowpeas still in there. I had some soybeans in there. This is an ear leaf. So you can see how dark green and little disease that has. You know, there's a little bit of gray leaf spot on it. But this field did not get sprayed with fungicide. Keep that in mind. Almost every single field around here gets sprayed with fungicide, and all the rest of our fields did, and this field has the least amount of gray leaf spot pressure out of any of them, hands down. And then here's an ear corn out of it, 16 by 44. It's just starting to dent. We've got plenty of moisture. Looks like things are going to cool off a little bit. I think we should be able to get a decent enough corn yield to justify running the combine through there. What do you guys think? Whether or not it's our best corn or not, I don't know. I'm not going to say that, but I don't think it will be. But it'll be fine. The other thing to notice, this was corn on corn, no-till corn on corn, that had all that interseed residue in it, all the interseed growth last year, all that spring cover crop growth this spring. How much residue do you see under here? Is that a lot of residue, or is that not very much? I mean, and those are all just piled up around earthworm middens. So it's not like it's just hanging out there. It's all getting gobbled up. By harvest time, there's not going to be anything there. They're probably going to start eating the cowpeas. Start pulling that stuff down. So here's continuation of the haney test results. So the test I showed you earlier are the blue lines. And then the 2018 stuff is the red and the orange. So remember that big bump we had in our P levels last year? That's just this little tiny, That's just that little tiny bump that I've got there on this graph. Went to the wrong side. I'll fix this. Thank you. letting it do its own thing, and then we get all that stuff unlocked. And why did it go way down, and why is it starting to go back up? I don't know, but I'm not really all that worried about it because we're doing tissue testing out there, and we've got like stupid high phosphorus levels in our corn plants. So, you know, it's all interesting to see though. Do you see that in other fields, Mitchell?
Not anywhere close.
No, we don't. So here's our K, you know, you can see it hasn't really done a whole lot. It bumped up early this spring, but it's kind of flattened off. So I don't know what's going on there. Here's our respiration. We had a big jump here in early to mid-July, up to over 300. And at the same time, our rehab levels went up to like 600. So I was looking at that, trying to figure out, okay, what happened there? You know, why did we have that big jump and then now we're back kind of down to where we were before? So I was looking at the weather, and from that sample was taken July 10th. And July 10th in here, around here, we had been pretty darn dry for about 2.5 weeks, 3 weeks, and it had been pretty darn hot as well. So what happens in that scenario when it gets hot and dry, our soils dry out, and our soil biology kind of goes dormant because they need moisture to do their thing. They're semi-aqueous creatures, so they need that soil water solution to be able to operate. So when we got hot and dry, they essentially took a nap, and then when it got re-wetted at the lab, it just exploded, and we got this big boost. And so we had that big boost on all of our tests that we had pulled that day from other fields and whatnot as well. This one's the biggest. So that was an interesting thing. So, you know, if you think about what happens when we get a rain and we've been dry, everything greens up, right? Well, a big part of it is because we're waking that biology back up and letting it do its thing after it's been kind of dormant for a little bit. So, all interesting stuff. Any questions on the hanging test results? Comments? That's all I've got. So, Holly.
So on the, when you're interseeding, well, not interseeding, but when you do the spring cover crops, what are you doing the fall before that?
So we had it on the field that got interseeded the prior year. And after we harvested, we had a whole bunch of little radish and mustard seedlings growing, these little tiny guys. And that was it. I mean, it was pretty late harvest. And I knew I wanted to do the spring cover crop stuff. And we had played around with oats a little bit the year before, broadcasting them in the spring into a stand of rye that was planted in November. So I thought, okay, if we're going to be able to get some oats to grow in the spring where we've got fall seeded stuff, something where it's really small and planted in November in the fall would be the place to do it. Well, that rye just outcompeted all that stuff. So I knew I wanted to put rye out there. It took a lot of self-control to not have something growing and have to stare out, it's right out my back window, have to stare at a field that's brown all winter long. Not that we had much of a choice anyways where we had rye, but yeah, so we didn't have anything in the fall other than what volunteered, and then yeah, as soon as the frost was out in the spring and it was dry at all, we got in there with the drill, but yeah, it took a month and a half to do anything. Yeah.
Have you done any spring seeding in rye before it kicks in the spring? The first March where the rye's already up there and then spring seed?
Yeah, that's what I was talking about. We went out and we broadcasted some oats into some rye like that 2 years ago, and it started growing, but then once that rye took off, it just choked everything out.
Okay.
So, and we had some places where the drill box ran empty and we had no rye, and we had not a great stand of oats, but we had a stand of oats in there. So I knew, it's not like the oats just didn't grow at all. We had oats where there was no rye, but where there was rye, there was definitely no oats.
Yeah. You talked about a roller, mentioned a roller. What kind of roller did you use?
Tractor tires. We don't have a roller yet. So anything that's been rolled in those pictures was just from the planter tractor driving down the rye. So just observing, you know, you've got four rows that are getting ran over by duals and whatnot, and then the middle row being by itself isn't a big deal. But so you've got a little gap there where it's like a roller hit it, and then your planter wings, everything's still standing. So So getting that stuff rolled down is what we're really wanting to do.
Have you looked at a roller? Looking at getting a roller?
Yeah, I've looked into it quite a bit, and there's some different options. You know, McFarland makes a stock chopper that some people use. And if you're still planning on using a herbicide to terminate the cover crop, then you're not as tied down on what your options are for a roller. You know, you don't necessarily need a big, heavy roller crimper that's going to be crimping it to terminate it. You just need something that's going to knock it down. And even if it stands back up a little bit, if it's at a 60-degree angle, as soon as it starts to die, it's going to fall over. Whereas if it's still standing up straight, what I saw is the stem breaks halfway, and then it's like, you know, all sorts of tangled up. So just getting that knocked down, I think, would do a lot of good.
Think about taking the mower out there?
Yeah, but I don't want to mow it, because then you have detached residue, and you get a big rain, and see you later. You know, so keeping everything anchored down is what you want.
Is the hay test pretty specific to corn and soybean rotation? Or can you apply to others?
You can use it on anything. It's almost better on pastures and whatnot, because you're going to typically have a lot higher organic nitrogen levels in pastures than you do in a row crop field. So if you're not using the Haney test to do nitrogen testing in a pasture, you're going to be missing out on a way bigger chunk of what's out there than you are, what we're doing.